could ask Louise if she'll read the scripture for us.
Oh, I thought it was going to go on the screen. Fine. This morning's scripture is from Luke chapter 19, beginning at the 28th verse. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, order your disciples to stop.' He answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out.'" God's word for God's people.
May our hearts hear and our lives respond.
Just got to fix it so I see more of you guys. This scripture is so important. The four gospels that we have lots of ways they're different. They don't all even tell us about Jesus' birth story. Only two of the gospels do that. But all four of them tell us about this Palm Sunday and tell us about Jesus' journey through Monday, Thursday, that Last Supper with the disciples, through the Garden of Gethsemane, to being arrested, crucified. They all take us through this passion story. And that's what we're about this week, connecting our hearts and lives to how essential this journey has been to who we are as God's people. And you know, in this crazy time of virus, to where our hope is. Where is our hope? Where is our strength? That's what this hard journey gets us ready for. And one of the things today's scripture helps us see is that when these things about Jesus riding on a donkey were happening, that was connecting for the Hebrew people with things they'd heard long ago from their prophets. The prophet Zechariah mentioned a king coming on a donkey, that idea of humility, the idea that you're not a king up and above crunching down your subjects like Yertle the turtle. Did you ever read that book? Not like that at all. Jesus was a humble king. God actually, in the Old Testament, keeps trying to talk people out of even wanting a king. God wants to deal directly with God's people, but they're afraid of that. And they say to Moses, "No, no, you do it. It's too scary for us." And then as time goes on, they want to be like the other people, keeping up with the Joneses. So they want their own king. And God warns them it's not a good idea, but they get a king and they bumble along with that, and there are disasters. But in among all this, the prophets are trying to help them understand God's intention for God's people. The part Jesus says about, "If I told my disciples to be quiet, even the stones would cry out. That comes from part of Habakkuk. You should read that book. It's short, but it's powerful. And that prophet is telling us about the sinfulness of people looking to control others, to crush others, to become rich at others' expense. Because God's will for us has always been for us to look out for each other, to help each other, to build people up. Even again and again, as those of us who are reading the one-year Bible are discovering, again and again, God brings up the aliens living among us and those folks who are poorer than we do, that it's our responsibility, it's God's call to our heart that we connect. So when Jesus comes into Jerusalem, the donkey, the insisting that even if his disciples were quieted down, and in Luke's gospel, there is not just the 12, there is a multitude of disciples. The crowds Luke calls disciples of Jesus. So in this particular gospel, there's a couple really, I think, powerful things to notice. One is about the cloaks that get put on the donkey's back for Jesus. You know, I grew up either on the back of a horse or in the top of a tree for 90% of my childhood. And when I rode my horse, I had saddles, but I preferred going bareback because it was just so much easier. You just slapped on your bridle and off you went. And I liked being able to, it felt like I was more connected to my horse. But the thing that always happens if you ride a horse bareback, those of us who have done that know, when you get off the horse, especially on a warm summer day, all the dirt, because you can't wash a horse all the time, even if you're good at brushing it, the dirt, the hair, the sweat is all over your rear end and your legs when you get off. You're a mess. And so when Jesus got on this donkey, people, his disciples were thinking about him, about taking care of him. And so they put their cloaks on top of the donkey. They didn't go and get saddle blankets or anything. They got the donkey and then they used their cloaks. And you might think, well, what's the big deal? They threw one of their jackets on the donkey. But it was a big deal because back in those days, most people had one outer cloak, one, and that had to serve them well. And it was too expensive to easily replace. It was not easily laundered, but they weren't thinking of themselves. Those disciples were thinking, well, we don't want Jesus getting hot and sweaty and dirty. Let's make it more comfortable for him. So they took care of him. That part feels really important to me. And the other part that feels important, again, in Luke's gospel, we're not hearing so much about palm branches or any kind of branches. We're hearing about those cloaks. So remember how valuable they were to people then? His disciples put some on the back of the donkey. And then what do all the other people do? Those other people take off their cloaks and throw them down on the road, on the filthy road for the donkey to walk on, because they did that sacrifice to so honor Jesus. They took something that was really personal, really precious, pretty valuable to them, and they just spread it out on the road to make a way for Jesus so that Jesus knew how much they cared. They esteemed him. They honored him. That's a powerful thing to me. And I think, I wonder what we can do today that would involve something valuable and personal that we could just throw out there to help, to let Jesus know that we honor Jesus. And these days, as Jesus' disciples, we don't just do these little secret things for God. It's good to keep our name out of the things that we do, But the things that we do to honor God are so important because they let other people who might not be so connected to Jesus know, whoa, there's somebody who's doing whatever it is because Jesus is that important. Speaking of how important Jesus was, this gospel has a part two that really kind of blows me away. You caught the part Louise read about Jesus telling the disciples to just go and find this little colt, this donkey, tied up, and untie it and bring it back. And Jesus says, if anybody asks you what you're doing, say, the Lord has need of it. Well, I noticed first off, those disciples didn't complain, which is kind of weird because we know through scripture, those guys were big complainers. You got to admit it. They always had questions and complaints about a lot of things. Remember when they were told to feed the hungry people and they had a couple loaves and some fish? Remember then Jesus says, will you feed them? And they were like, what the heck? Do you see all we have? And Jesus said, get out, use what you have. And they gave it to Jesus. And by putting it in Jesus' hands, it was enough. Well, this time, and this is quite a miracle, they don't even bother to say, wait a minute, we're going to get in trouble. Do you want us arrested for horse stealing before we can get back? There are no complaints. They just go and do it. That's amazing. Then the next amazing part is that when they get there, they untie it, and just when we're thinking, oh, good, they're going to get away with it, someone does indeed say, hey, what are you doing? And they say, they don't make up some fancy story, they actually say just what Jesus told them to say. They don't add anything to it. They don't take anything away. They say exactly what Jesus asked. Another miracle. They say the Lord has need of it. And that was enough. That was enough for the people who owned the donkey. Okay, Jesus, our Lord, needs it. Somehow there was acceptance of that. Now, when you read commentaries on the Bible, there are, and I'm sure even in conversations, you've thought about this before, and there are a lot of explanations for this miracle of people just saying okay and letting them take the donkey and how the disciples were able to find it. Some people say, well, it makes more sense that Jesus would have had a prearrangement. He would have already set it up with these people so then he could send the disciple and it was already straightened out for them. It's possible, I suppose. But those of us who've been through the Gospels a few times can't help noticing that Jesus, while he could do miracles, while he could do healing, he was not so good at setting stuff up and arranging details. He just didn't. Thank goodness people were showing up like the tax collector and inviting him home. People were calling him to come to their house to eat. The disciples were running off and procuring food and bringing it back. We don't really hear about Jesus doing much of anything at all until that maybe that one day he sits down at the well with the woman there and he asks her for a drink. As near as I can figure, that's as far as Jesus usually goes to setting up something like that. And it really just kind of fell into place and happened. So I don't know what you think. I kind of discount that theory. I think in Luke's gospel, it says, it talks about the multitude of disciples. And we know that Jesus was running around healing people, teaching, and sending out his disciples. So I honestly think that, you know, he knew there would be this donkey. And he trusted that God's own Holy Spirit would work in these people's hearts when they got the request. And by God, literally, by God, It did. It worked that way. These people were enough of disciples of Christ that when they were asked for something for Jesus, they said, sure. So in this Holy Week, I'm thinking, I wonder how often something will be asked of me, not just this week, but maybe in the weeks to come, maybe something will be asked of me that I just need to say yes to. And the only way I'll know if it's a yes thing, or, you know, sometimes you really have to say, well, thank you, but no, thank you. Like if you get offers for help with your government check, if you just give them your social security number, or if you get an offer for a free ticket, if you just can give them blah, 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 no, say no to that stuff. But sometimes there will be something that nudges your heart and you just feel like, oh, that call is for me. And answer it just because Jesus asked. So those are the miracles that are really touching my heart this Palm Sunday that are making me think. And dear Lord, there's too much time to think these days, isn't there? And I try to turn my thinking time into praying time. And I have never done so much Bible study in my entire life. And I've been through seminary and a doctoral program in a seminary. But I am telling you, these weeks of being shut in the house are topping that. And I'm also thinking that that's one thing God is asking of us in this season of Lent. And in the coming Holy Week, how do we just, as one Palm Sunday church sign said, keep your ass at home? How do we do that in a way that is loving for other people? How do we stop thinking, well, I have just this exception or that exception? How do we just stay where we are to protect other people? We may be willing to risk ourselves, but there are plenty of people out there with compromised immune system, any number of things that we don't know about. And we used to think, it's just older folks that are at risk. Well, it's not. There are kids who are even getting this, so we have to be careful. And that's a hard thing that we're called to do, but by God, we can do. So my prayer for all of us in this Holy Week from Palm Sunday today until Easter Sunday next Sunday is that we really dare to go the distance with Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I'm going to invite us to get our hearts ready.